The Radio Memories Network is brought to you in part by Liberated Syndication, podcast publishing made easy, libsyn.com. That's libsyn.com.
Welcome to the Old Time Radio Network Detective Stories, continuing America's love affair with private eyes. We now go back to the early days of radio and our imaginations with our feature presentation.
Being a private investigator means two things. You can be sure you'll run into trouble, and you can never be sure you'll get out of it. Well, there's not much you can do about it, I guess. Except, like Julie always says,
walk softly, Peter Troy.
And now Peter Troy investigates the Vulnerable Vixen.
Women are wonderful, but in my business they usually spell trouble. In this case, with a capital T for Tommy Gun. It all started with a girl named Shane. Unusual? Yeah, so was the girl. A wispy brunette as deadly as she's beautiful. With a fondness for fast cars and rhythm. Rhythm with a beat. A staccato beat. Like this.
Cut down through the Ketley Mews and into Knightsbridge. No one saw us. The street was empty. Lose the car in the late night traffic.
What up?
Shady, you crazy? We should be heading out of town.
Rick, please remember I'm running this outfit, will you?
Yeah, and if you're not careful, you'll run us right into Dartmoor. Look, this isn't Chicago. This is London town, and a protection racket...
Works just as well here as anywhere. The only thing is, it's never been really organized before, that's all.
Yeah, but submachine guns...
So far, we've only used them to break windows. Generally scare up the shopkeepers, haven't we?
Sure, but one of those flying bullets only has to hit someone.
And the man pulling the trigger is facing a murder rap. The man being you, Rick.
On your orders.
Who's to know that?
A shame.
Now, look. Since I arrived in from the States, we've netted over £20,000. It's more than $40,000 in real money. That's in just over a month's operation. Are you complaining?
You don't know about the police here.
They don't scare me. We have to have them back home. We can look after them here.
Here, we're coming into Knightsbridge.
Okay, Hal. Slow down, find some place to park, and we ditch the car.
Right up.
You know something, Rick? I like this town. It has elegance, you know what I mean? Tradition, pomp, respectability. This place is wide open for us. You know why? Because the Britisher always goes along with the idea that it can never happen here.
And now?
Well, it has happened now. And I made it happen. And these folk are going to have to like it or lump it.
You're a bit rich for my blood, Shane.
Oh, you worry too much. Now, be a good boy and dismantle that Tommy gun and pack the parts in that case. Work's finished for the day. So, you can take me down to the Morocco for a drink.
Of course, no one knew that the wispy 5-foot brunette had anything to do with the sudden outbreak of violence in the city. This looked like Chicago days of prohibition all over again. In a month, 8 large stores, not just small-time shopkeepers, mind you, had their show windows smashed by a hail of Tommy gun bullets. And there's something very unpleasant about the whine and clatter of a burst of machine gun fire. It's intimidating, to say the least. You get to thinking, if it can make that much of a mess to window and shop fittings, what's it going to do to you? Anyway, speeding cars dashing through darkened streets and bullets in the night were far from my thoughts on a certain spring morning just recently. I had other things in my mind. Things like money. Business has been kind of slow lately, and those bills were piling up.
Pete, you have a visitor.
I've gone to China. I've set up shop in Suzhou. I am but definitely not at home, Julie.
To a client?
With money?
Well, I don't know whether this one has money or not.
Huh.
Friend of yours, Detective Inspector Caswell of New Scotland Yard.
Oh, no. Mm-hmm. He's getting to be more of a menace than Mellonby.
Don't worry, Troy. Your creditors haven't set Scotland Yard, aren't you? All right, have I sit down?
Yeah, if you insist.
Don't worry, Inspector. He always looks like that first thing in the morning.
First thing in the morning? It's after 11:30.
You live your life, I live mine.
Part of your daily routine include reading the newspapers?
So what's Dick Tracy up to this morning? This.
Yes, that. Large areas of plate glass windows were smashed by machine gun bullets last night when mobsters shot up a luxury store in West Kensington.
You know, this sort of trouble's foreign to London, Peter.
Well, now it isn't. Anyway, why come to me, Murray?
Well, we have to wipe this thing out before it gets any bigger.
I hope you're using the royal plural. This is a police headache.
Yes,
not...
yes, that's true. But sometimes we can use a little help.
Oh, now, wait a minute.
And if Scotland Yard knew I was coming to you, I'd get kicked out of the force before you could say Julia.
Don't tempt me. Anyway, what sort of help do you think I can give?
Look, we can't fight this outbreak by using the rule book. We've tried, but it doesn't work.
So?
So, unconventional methods have to be used.
Such as?
Well, there's no one in London who operates in a more unconventional way than you, so far as I'm aware, anyway.
Is that a backhanded compliment?
Well, let's put it this way, Troy. You can go places denied to policemen. You can make inquiries unhampered by formalities and red tape.
Mm-hmm. I'm listening.
Well, I've been assigned to this case.
And?
And I want you in on it. In an unofficial capacity.
Oh, wait a minute, Inspector. That doesn't sound very profitable.
Oh, the police can't make bargains, you know that. But I'll tell you this, Peter. Help me to land this mob, and I'll make sure that... An expense fund is made available to you.
Well, my landlord will be pleased about that. Okay, what have you got so far in this business?
Well, now, the racket follows classical Chicago lines, you know, protection. Shopkeepers and store owners either pay up or...
The Tommy Gunner pays them a visit.
Yes.
Any names?
Well, they always steal a car to do the job, then they dump it. Well, this time it was spotted. We found it abandoned in Knightsbridge.
Huh?
Yeah. The fingerprint boys have dusted every inch of it. The scientific lab have been over it, too.
Did they come up with anything?
No, they didn't. Everyone must have been using gloves. Well, the legal owner of the car is Prinsall over it, of course, but there was one complete set, which, given us pretty healthy sort of a clue, just one set, mind you.
Mm.
They belong to Rick Vendone. At some stage, he must have taken his gloves off.
Vendone? Oh, one of the boys that gave Chicago a bad name. Well, sir, why don't you haul him in?
Because he's a trigger man, not a brain. We want the person behind this business.
Rick Vendone, huh? Just a two-bit hoodlum.
But at least he's a lead. Not that we can do anything about it. If we investigate him...
You scare off the big fish. Right, I've got the picture.
Lend a hand?
Sure. I owe you a favor.
Thanks, Peter. Now, any ideas?
One... That's as unconventional as a beatnik's tea party. And I'll tell you something else, Murray. You're not going to like this idea at all.
Yeah, I know you, Troy. You're a snooper. I don't like snoopers.
I'll just bet you don't, Vendone.
Look, I got no business with you. Roll on out, will you? I got a date. Not in particular what sort of company my girlfriend finds me in.
Is she a music lover, Rick?
Come again?
Well, does she go for the staccato beat? You know, like the ragged rhythm of a Thompson submachine gun, maybe.
I don't know what you're talking about.
Talking about the 37 bullets they picked up at a West Kensington store the other night, buddy.
So what's that got to do with me?
I wouldn't have any idea. Except that the law seems anxious to tie in with the Cape.
You know, wait a minute.
Relax. Nowhere near making an arrest yet.
And what in blazes are you...
Just found a couple of prints in a stolen car, that's all. Go on, look around. You're not even being shadowed.
Well, how come you know all this, Troy?
Oh, I tell you, I got a visitor up at my Chelsea office this morning.
Like what?
Like Detective Inspector Caswell of Scotland Yard. He's been assigned to the West Kensington case.
Well, so what? I'm not interested.
Oh, well, you ought to be. That's why I'm here. See, Caswell wants me in on the case.
Well?
I said I would be in it. But the police don't pay very well, Rick.
Yeah, that's right. I hear they got a set fee for stool pigeons.
And it's peanuts. You reading me now?
Loud and clear. Tell me more.
No, there's little else to tell. Except I've got financial worries. Police payoff isn't going to lighten them any either.
Yeah, I just thought I might be able to make something on the side. Doing what?
Well, making like I'm working in with Scotland Yard, but in reality, my loyalties could be with you, Rick. Well, it's a very simple scheme. It could pay you big dividends. Look,
I feed him phony information, lead him off the track. At the same time, I relay the movements of the case to you.
Interested?
You tell me this, Troy. How did the cops tie me in with this business?
You all wore gloves, right? Okay, but a Thompson's a tricky piece of machinery. At some stage, you had to take off your gloves to handle it. And then, Ricky boy, you got careless. You put your bare hand on the sill of the car window. How am I doing?
Hold it, Troy. Don't turn around.
Taking the night air, Rick?
Put your hands behind your back, Snooper. Regulation handcuffs. You can't shake them. I'm going to put a blindfold over your eyes, Snooper. All right. Now turn around. Walk.
You always go around...
Pipe down. There's a car right in front of you. Now get in. Okay, let's get moving. Something wrong, Troy?
That's a really cute aftershave lotion you're using, Rick.
Troy, I told you to pipe down.
Spirelli's Touch of Paradise, 18 guineas an ounce. I bet she's a brunette.
The girlfriend, Rick, the music lover?
I like this one. He's cute.
Thanks. You sound cute, too. You smell even cuter.
Say, you mind if I ask a question?
What is it?
Where are we going?
The country. It's so peaceful out there.
Like a grave.
This is the end of the line, huh?
Correct, Mr. Troy.
Out.
Now listen.
Out.
I do like the man said, Mr. Troy. It makes it so much easier.
Makes what so much easier?
You'll find out. Get moving, Troy.
Bye, Mr. Troy. Nice meeting you.
I never even got to see your big brown eyes.
You were right about me being a brunette.
All right, Troy. This is far enough.
Curtains?
Uh-huh. Too bad we got no closing music, Troy.
Now, Rick Van Doan may not have been strong on brains, but the killer instinct he had in ample supply. I stood there helpless, blindfolded and handcuffed. I heard the hammer on Rick's gun being eased back.
I'll bet you never thought it would end like this, huh, Troy? Out here, away from the city lights... No one to watch you go out in a blaze of glory.
Get on with it, Rick. You're wasting time.
So what? We got all the time in the world.
I'd just like to know why, that's all.
Because the lady wants it that way.
Well, if I said anything nice about her, I'd take it all back.
How do you feel, Troy?
How would you feel?
All right, Rick.
Now what?
Close shave, huh? Hold still while I get these bracelets off you.
But I don't get it.
Yeah, that's right. You don't get it. This time. Okay, you can take off the blindfold.
What was all that about?
I want you to remember that little scene, Mr. Troy.
I'm never likely to forget it, lady.
I want you to remember it any time you get ideas about playing in double cross.
Oh, I see.
As a matter of fact, your proposition interested me. An inside man at a Scotland Yard, it opens up unlimited possibilities. If I know how the cops are working, then I can keep just one step ahead, can't I?
Mm-hmm.
You American, Mr. Troy?
Canadian, Montreal.
Mm-hmm. Now, back home in the States, when an operation of this size is organized, you make sure you've covered yourself with the police. However, I'm told you can't buy them off here in London, so we do the next best thing.
And he feeds him phony information, too.
Yeah, keeps him guessing. My name's Shane, Mr. Troy. I like a first-name basis with my boys.
Oh, that's democratic, Shane. I'm Peter.
I like you, Peter. You play things square with me, and you're never going to be worried about your creditors.
Well, that's nice.
Naturally, I have to have some insurance. We played out that little scene to remind you of your obligations. If we play it again, we play it to the end.
You won't have to.
Well, I have to be sure, you know. And I always take out two sets of insurance policies.
Two?
That's right. Your curvy little red-headed secretary.
Julie, what about her?
She's my guest, Peter.
Now you listen.
She's perfectly safe, and she stays that way for just as long as you play ball with us. You don't, and she goes first.
You have no idea where they're holding, Julie?
None at all, Murray.
Peter, I'm sorry about this.
No, it's my fault. But if they harm...
Yes, I know. We have to go very carefully. In the meantime, what have you got to report?
Oh, they've got the game sewn up. The big boss is a woman.
A woman?
Yeah. She's as deadly as arsenic, Inspector. American, and her name's Shane. That's about all I know. Oh, except she wears expensive perfume. She's a brunette and a looker.
Yeah, I see. I have the details sent to the FBI Washington and try and get a set of prints. What's their next move?
Randerson's departmental store, Fulham Road. The owner's kicking up a fuss about the high premium he has to pay for protection. They'll hit the place tomorrow night.
Right. I'll have a squad.
No.
No?
They've got Julie, remember?
You ever use one of these things, Troy?
I played around with one in Korea.
When you use it tonight, it'll bring back nostalgic memories.
When I use it?
Uh-huh.
But you...
You're doing the job tonight, honey.
Why?
Let's just call it your initiation, huh?
Here, we're getting in close.
I get a good one, Troy.
A whole magazine. Now I don't want to see a piece of glass left standing when you're finished.
Listen, if there's anyone on the streets...
Yeah, I used to be worried about that.
It's just too bad, isn't it?
We're here. Slow down, Al.
Okay.
It's all yours, Peter.
Right.
What are you waiting for?
Not a thing.
Nice place you have here, Shane.
It's home. Ice in your scotch?
Uh-huh.
You did well tonight.
Thanks.
You get a bonus. £100.
Just for squeezing the trigger on the Thompson?
I said I liked you.
That's nice.
Rick's okay, but he has no brains, no class. I have to have a lieutenant I can respect.
It helps.
Someone like you, Peter. How's your scotch?
Smooth.
What are you looking at?
Photo over there on the bookcase. Who's he?
The husband.
Uh-uh.
Oh, don't worry. He died 5 years ago.
Accident?
He sat down in an armchair and some guy pulled a switch.
The hot seat?
In the state penitentiary. I pull out the picture of him sometimes. I'm a sentimentalist.
Yes, I've noticed.
He was good to me. Unfortunately, he made just one mistake.
What was that?
He trusted someone. He didn't take out insurance policies.
Did he get even with the person who sold them out?
I'm still here, aren't I?
We've got a new lead from Troyer, Sergeant. He saw a picture of a man he recognized in the woman's apartment. He was in the States 5 years ago. The man was executed, and...
Who was it, Inspector?
Racketeer called Benny Donahue. Now, this Shane woman says he was her husband.
Oh, now we're really getting somewhere.
Yes. Oh, we can pick up Shane Donahue anytime we like, but there's still Troy's secretary to worry about. We make a wrong move and Julie dies.
Yes, it's a snag, all right.
Well, the Donahue woman must have learned everything she knows from Benny. He was a specialist in the protection racket, made a lot of money at it. Very rich man when he died.
Wonder what he did with it all.
Oh, invested it, probably. Real estate, stocks and shares, you know. Our record department said he came to England on a trip about 8 years ago, so let's check up on that. Cable Washington and have Inspector Greenlee find out what he was doing here. There could be an angle hidden somewhere. But until we find it, we are virtually bound and gagged.
We have to do it. There's no way around it. Mr. Kavanaugh, the owner of Kavanaugh's Delicatessen, has to die.
Why?
Because he's bucking, Pete. We pushed him too far. He can start singing any time.
When do I do the job, Shane?
You don't. Pete here does it.
Me?
That's right.
But I...
You do it right, and that little redhead of yours goes free.
And if I refuse?
Use your imagination.
Thanks.
Shane, I think...
Don't.
Look, supposing I...
Mr. Troy?
That's me.
A telephone, sir. You can take it over at the desk.
Thanks. You'll excuse me?
Hurry back. We have a lot to discuss.
Shane, he won't do it.
Find out who's phoning him. Tell Jerome to let you use one of the extensions. Someone must be shadowing him. This isn't one of his regular spots. I don't like it, Rick.
Hello, this is Peter Troy.
Well, I've located you.
Caswell, what the devil are you doing phoning me here? I told you...
Just keep quiet for a minute and listen. This is important. We've just discovered some vital information.
About what?
About a trip Shane Donahue's husband made to England 8 years ago.
Go on.
It was a business trip, Peter. Seems he came here to invest some dollars he'd made out of the protection racket in Chicago.
So?
Well, he invested in real estate. Bought some houses, five of them. Two in Luton, Bedfordshire, one in Bristol.
Well, get to the point.
Well, Peter, they have tenants in them. All but one. There's a house standing empty just outside Chigwell in Essex.
Julie.
Right. And that's probably where they're holding out.
How far out of London is this place?
About 12 miles. It's on the Romford Road, a cottage called Briar Close.
I'm on my way.
Now, Troy, wait a minute.
Who is it?
Peter Troy, Hal. Let me in. I've got a message from Shane.
Come in.
Hal, where's Julie?
You better ask Shane.
Oh, she's at the Morocco.
I was.
What?
It would seem we have a faster car than you, Pete. Rick tuned in on your chit-chat with the inspector.
Is Julie still alive?
Bring her out, Rick.
I told you this guy wasn't to be trusted.
Oh, Peter.
Hi, Julie.
You've just got time to say your fond farewells.
Now, listen, Julie had nothing to do with
this,
Shane.
My insurance, remember? The police come within a mile of this house and she dies.
They're on their way.
I know that. So you've got to figure out some way of getting rid of them, haven't you?
And after that, you get yours, Snooper.
They're here already.
He's bluffing.
Hey, Shane, he could be right. There's someone moving out there.
You've still got to get rid of them, Troy. We hold the girl as a hostage. Rick, take his gun.
Cover me, Hal.
Okay.
He wears a shoulder holster.
Easy, Troy. Get your hands up.
I've got a feeling this is goodbye, Pete.
Get her out of the way. She's in my line of fire.
You'll move.
He's gone for his gun!
Troy, don't shoot.
Okay, drop your gun.
Rich, you spineless!
He moved too fast, Shane. The gun jumped into his hand before I could get to him.
You hear that? I told you the police were outside. Well, I guess that just about does it, Julie.
She's very nice to look at, isn't she?
To look at, that's all.
You know something?
Hmm?
You took an awful risk back there getting in the line of fire. Don't do it again, huh?
Do I get a bonus, boss?
Name it.
A bottle of Spirelli's Touch of Paradise. That's what Shane wears, isn't it?
Who cares what she wears?
You spent a lot of time with her, didn't you?
Strictly in the line of business.
Mm. Funny business.
You talk too much.
Oh, it's so much nicer when you walk softly, Peter Troy.
This is the United States Armed Forces Radio and Television Service.